So in the previous video, we stored some strings in variables, but we didn't really explain what was going on. So we want to go through and actually explain what is happening a little bit more now behind the scenes. So when the Python program is running, everything the program needs ends up being stored somewhere in the computer's memory. Now, you don't actually need to know where that is because the computer actually tracks that. The program code itself, in other words, the instructions that you type in, will be stored in one area of memory, but also the data that it's going to work on, the variables that you've typed in, etc., will be stored somewhere else in memory. So the variable, the name that we assign, is just really a way to give a meaningful name to an area of memory into which we can place certain values, like strings and so forth. So when we create a variable called greeting, like greeting equals Bruce, Python's actually allocating an area of computer memory for us, and it knows to refer to that area whenever we talk about the variable greeting. So think of it like a box in memory that's storing the values Bruce in this case, and the box has got a name on it, it's got a sticker on it that says greeting, and when we type in greeting, the computer knows to go and find the value that's in that particular box. So that all happens automatically behind the scenes. Now, just in terms of creating these variable names, there are a few rules to keep in mind when you're actually creating them. Firstly, the actual name has to start with either a letter, which can be upper or lowercase, or an underscore. So in other words, we can type underscore my name equals Tim. That's valid. So I know a variable name can start with either the letter or an underscore, but we can't start with a number. Actually get an error. But we can actually also use letters, but we can also use numbers in our variable names, just not as the first letter. So we could put something like Tim 45 equals good. That's quite valid. And we could put a combination. So we could put Tim underscore was underscore 57 equals hello. And that's quite valid as well. Now, the other thing important thing to consider here is that I can also type a variable name called greeting with uppercase G. And that's different and distinct to this variable name. So that one's all in lowercase. This one's got an uppercase first letter. Even though the actual word is the same, they are treated as different variable names as far as Python is concerned. Now, in terms of the allocation of memory, it actually happens at the point that you've initialized it. So in other words, once you've typed in the variable name and put an equal and then the value, at that point, Python will then allocate the space for that in the computer's memory. Now, in terms of using variables, we saw that we could use the print statement to print some out. We could do something like Tim was here, or Tim was 57, plus single quote space, plus greeting. We could run that. Hello, Bruce. So obviously it's taking the value of hello from Tim was 57 and Bruce from the variable greeting and actually putting that on the screen with a space between the two there. We could do something like age equals 24, print age. And we can also do something like greeting plus age. So let's run this program. Now, this is where we actually get an error. So you can see it showed the first hello Bruce, which we saw before, which was this first line. We then assigned the value of 24 to the variable age, and we printed the age, which 24 worked. But then it tried to do this next line, print greeting plus age, and we actually got an error in red. And you can see that Python's actually trying to help you here by actually sort of saying, look, I've got a problem with what you've typed. It's actually come up and actually said, I can't convert int object to a string, str is the abbreviation for a string, implicitly. So what we've tried to do is get it to do something that Python can't work with, and this is what happens when you get an error. So Python will helpfully show you some information which hopefully leads to you figuring out what the problem was, and it actually shows also the actual line. So if we move over a little bit, we can see it's saying the name of the Python file, which was one that I created for this video, variables.py, and says line 12, which equates to line 12 over here. So it's very handy to look at these when you're trying to figure out whether there's a problem, and you can go back to line 12 and know, okay, this is where the problem was. Now, the other thing is that IntelliJ actually does a lot of this for you automatically as well. It tries to help you out with hints as well. So over here, we can see these little dashes. If I actually hover over there with my mouse, we actually get a helpful error message. Expected type string, str, got int instead. So that's IntelliJ trying to give you some information to say you've got this wrong, basically. And so it can be really useful when you're creating Python programs to keep checking these hints out to see whether there actually is an issue. Notice also there's a keyboard shortcut if you want to expand this to get some more information. So on a Mac, I can actually type Command F1. I get more information like so, and press Control F1 on a Windows machine or a Linux machine, and you can get the full message. So it's very handy to actually refer to that all the time. And look, later in the course, we will be looking at handling these errors. So in other words, if your program crashes or goes to crash, we can sort of handle that more gracefully. But for now, think of those error messages that come up as your friend. Because what it's really doing, it's telling you that your code's not going to work and providing as much information as possible to you to help you try and figure out what the solution is. So while it can be frustrating, you really do learn a lot from errors like these because you can figure out something that Python doesn't like and how to work around that to come up with actually a solution. Okay, so moving on, and later in the course, we'll be talking about these conversions. So in terms of this particular error message, what's actually happening was, again, that we determined that Python wasn't happy because we were trying to add the age, the numeric variable age, to a number. And you can't actually do that. It doesn't actually work like that. So Python doesn't know what to do in that scenario. It knows what to do in a situation like this. We're actually adding strings together because Tim was 57 is a string and greeting was a string, and it knows to concatenate those. Likewise, if we try to do something with two numbers, it knows to add the sum of those two numbers. But in this scenario where we've got a string and a number, Python doesn't actually know how to do that, not to know how to handle that, and that's why we actually got the message. So we'll be dealing more with how to actually get around that. And do note that some other programming languages, Java being one of them, does actually allow you to actually do something like that. And in that scenario, what will happen is it'll actually automatically convert that what you're trying to do. In this case, it would append the value of 24 to the string age. But Python doesn't do that. It makes you get it right at the start. And that's actually a good thing in many ways because it means that you're not going to be getting any weird little bugs that crept about because of automatic type conversion that you may get in other programming languages. So the bottom line is you need to get that right first. And really, it's just a matter of checking out the error message and fixing it. And we'll be talking more about this type of thing as the course progresses anyway. So moving on, let's talk now a little bit about variable types. So Python's got several built-in data types, and we've got a heap of them, and we'll be dealing with those in detail. Data types can be classified as numerics, sequences, mappings, files, classes, instances, and exceptions. And I know that sounds like a lot, and it probably is, but you'll be introduced to all of these as the course progresses. But for now, we're going to look at numeric data types and one of the sequence types, which you've already seen, string being a sequence type, which we've actually looked at before. Now, Python 2, the old version of Python, which, as I mentioned, is no longer being used, and we're not using that in this course, that actually had various data types such as int, long, float, and complex. But in Python 3, the change they've made is that it's no longer a long type, and the int now behaves like a long used to. So they've really consolidated the amount of data types. Now, we're not going to discuss complex numbers. Without going into too much detail, a complex number contains a real and an imaginary part based on the square root of minus 1. Now, if you understand a complex number and want to use Python to manipulate them, then by the end of the course, you'll understand Python well enough to do so. But really, the complex number theory is an advanced branch of mathematics, slash engineering, and it's not really appropriate to go into too much detail with that. But let's look at the basic data types. And a basic data type, we're going to start with an integer. So an integer being a whole number, so a number that hasn't got any decimal points. So as you can see on the screen, I've typed in an integer. So an integer is just a whole number. That's a number having no fractional part. You know, whereas a float, in the other example, is another name for a real number, numbers having that is a number having a fractional part after the decimal point. Now, there's a very small number of computer languages that make no distinction between real numbers and integers. I guess you could say that integers can be considered just special cases of real numbers. But when represented in a computer, computations using integers, these whole numbers, are significantly faster than using floating point numbers. So that's one of the main reasons that we actually distinguish in programming an integer as a whole number and a real number, or floating point number, and that's because it's a lot faster to process. So anything that doesn't need, as a general rule, a floating point number for calculation purposes, you shouldn't actually be using it because you find that your programs will operate a lot faster because of it. There are pros and cons. One of the ways that, because of the way that integers are stored in the computer's memory, there's actually a limit to the size of an int. So it's about 9 trillion in European terms, which I think is 9 quintillion in American format. But effectively, the Python 2 long data type and the Python 3 int effectively have no real maximum size. Now, floating point numbers, on the other hand, that's floats, they're used to represent numbers having a fractional part. So the maximum float value on a 64-bit computer is, well, it's just huge. We'll go through that. It's quite large. Basically, a number that actually moves the decimal point 308 places to the right. And the smallest float number is a negative number, which has 307 zeros before the decimal float. So it's obviously a decimal point, I should say. So it's obviously a huge variance, and a huge number can be stored in that floating point number. Floating points have 52 digits of precision, which should be adequate for most purposes for financial calculations where you're needing decimals. Now, because Python doesn't really have variable declarations, and that's where you specify the type of a variable before you can use it, and lots of other languages, computer languages do that, it's probably tempting to think that you don't need to understand the difference between an int, a long, and a float type, but really it is something you really need to consider when writing your programs. And this makes more sense when we look at some of the operators that can be performed on numbers. So let's just go through a few scenarios. So I typed a variable called a with a value of an integer value of 12. Let's do another one, b equals 3. And let's perform some calculations. We'll do print. We do a plus b. We should get the value of 15. A, take b. We should get the value of 9. Print a times b, the value of 36 we should get. And we'll test this shortly. A divided by b. We should get the answer of 4, but there's a special rule there about that, which I'll talk about shortly. And I'm going to introduce another operator. Slash slash b, and I'll explain that shortly. And last one we're going to use is the remainder. Remainder of a divided by b, effectively. Otherwise, dividing 12 by 3, how much remainder is left after that. So let's just run this and then I'll just go through it. So the first one's 15, second one's 9, third value is 36. But notice the fourth one, a divided by b, the actual answer is returned as a float with a dot decimal point, dot zero. And that's the thing to keep in mind with a divide, a division operation. In Python, by default, it returns as a float. If you want the result to return as an integer, a whole number, you need to use the two slashes in this case. So a slash slash b returns 4 as a whole number. And lastly, the remainder of a divided by b was 0 because b goes into a 4 times. 4 times 3 is 12 and there'll be no remainder. So that's how you do some basic calculations in Python. Now this slash and slash slash can really trip you up, and we're going to be talking about loops later, but I just want to give you an example of typing in a loop where you could get into difficulty without using that slash or slash slash, because it can be a common source of problems. So let's look at an example here. We're going to type in some code. And again, we'll talk more about this for and the concept of loops later. But for now, we'll just type it in for I in range 1, 4, colon, print I. So if we run this, we get the values 1, 2, 3. But if we actually change this here, we put a divided by b, because instead of putting a constant number, a literal, we can actually put an expression like so. If we run that, we actually get an error, and that's because float object cannot be interpreted as an integer, and that's because the answer, if you remember, with division by default is a floating point number, and the range actually needs an integer, so we'd actually put two slashes in that scenario, run the code again, and actually correctly returns the results 1, 2, and 3. As we progress through the course, you'll see other ways of actually handling this, but I just wanted to point that out. At this point in time, that's a common source of problems when you're looking at Python for the first time. And again, don't be too worried about the concepts of what this is doing. We'll be covering loops, which what this actually is, in future videos. So the code, something like a plus b, that's actually an expression, and I mentioned expressions. In Python, an expression is anything that can be calculated to return a value. So we've really only used simple expressions to date, like a plus b or a take b, but we can get a lot more complex. We could do something, I'll just clear some space here. That's a lot more complex if we want to. We could do something like print a plus b divided by 3 take 4 times 12. And that's quite a valid expression. So if we actually run this, you might be surprised to look at that and think, well, why has that come up with the value of 35? You'd expect looking at that, that it would be, the answer should actually be 12. It should be like a plus b is 15 divided by 3 is 5, take 4 is 1, times 12 is 12. So why have we actually got 35 here instead of 12? Now don't worry, your computer's not broken and you can reliably perform arithmetic in Python. But as is the case in all programming languages, you have to understand some of the basic rules of the arithmetic operators. The problem here is operator precedence. Now, operator precedence is a fancy term for the relative importance given to each of the operators. If all operators were equal, we would get the expression how I read it earlier by calculating a plus b is 15 divided by 3 is 5, take 4 is 1 times 12 is 12. But the thing to remember is multiplication and division have higher operator precedence than addition and subtraction. So those operators are performed first. And most languages you'll find work in the same way. So this is not just peculiar to Python. So what's actually happening is b divided by 3, this is actually happening first. So b divided by 3 is happening first, which is 1. Then 4 times 12 is added, which is 48. So the expression is actually evaluated as 12 plus 1 is 13, take 48, which is negative 35. That's weird, but that's the way it actually happens by default, because multiplication and division, as I mentioned, have got a higher precedence. So in the case where you've actually got expressions that use just those operators, they will actually work from left to right. So we could type a divided by 2 times 3, and that should give us the answer of 4 times 3 is 12. So if we run that, we actually get the answer of 12. And even something like 8 times 3 divided by 2, 24 divided by 2 is 12. We get the answer correct. So the best way to actually overcome this, if you want your expressions to be clear and unambiguous, to use parentheses freely, even when Python doesn't specifically require them. So in our earlier example, the one that didn't work, this first line here, so we could do something like print a plus b divided by 3, take 4 times 12. Now there's a lot of brackets here, but what we're doing is we're actually putting the expressions in parentheses to make it clear what we're trying to perform. And when we actually run it, we actually correctly now get the answer of 12. So you can see we've got a plus b in its own set of brackets. That's going to be 15. But then outside to that, there's this bracket here which covers that. So therefore, that calculation is now 15 divided by 3, which is 3. Then take 4 from that is 1, and then multiply by 12 is 12, and that's why we're getting the answer of 12. Okay, so I'm going to stop the video here. In the next video, we're going to continue on talking about variables and operator precedence, etc. So I'll see you in that next video.